Hi, everyone. Welcome to our live keynote with KT Horning. We are so sorry that we are about 20 minutes late. We had some technical difficulties, which those of you in the library world will know sometimes happens. But we're here. KT is here. I'm Kira, for those of you that don't know. I just want to say a quick thank you to everyone. And Shelley, did you have any announcements really quickly?
I'm Shelley Diaz, for those of you who don't know, and thank you again. We will be sending a survey in the next few days about the course in general, and please be honest with your feedback. We want to hear from you. Thank you so much for your patience.
And without further ado, our keynote guest speaker, KT Horning, we're going to swing it over to you. And let you take it away, and then we'll come back at the end for some Q&A.
Okay, great, thanks. All right, am I on?
You're on.
Okay, great. Well, thanks. Thanks for persevering through all of the technical glitches. And I'm KT Horning, as Kira said, and I'm really, really looking forward to doing this session with you all. First of all, I want to commend SLJ for doing this. I think it's great that they are taking responsibility in this way. And I also want to commend all of you who are either attending live or who will be watching the archive discussion. I am going to be using a PowerPoint presentation so I can show you things other than just my face. And this is something I'm just going to bring up the share screen now. And let's see. Are you seeing the screen yet? Share.
Not yet. We still see your face, KT.
Hey, oh, you're so lucky. let me try that again. I can't tell you how many times I practiced this while I was waiting for the technical thing, part of it. And now it is gone. Man, the same thing happened to Debbie Reese. Okay.
It's okay. Take your time. We've waited this long.
The thing though. Oh, there it is. Okay. That now?
Yes.
Okay, great. And I'm going to put it in slideshow mode and hopefully that will work. You got it all? So you should be seeing reading and evaluating through a diverse lens, right?
Yes, I see that.
Okay. All right, great. So this is what I'm going to cover today. It's going to be in three sections. I'm first going to talk a little bit about CCVC diversity statistics, just to give us a little bit of a context when we evaluate books for diversity. I think it's really helpful to know the context that they exist in. And then the second part, I will be covering tips for increasing your sensitivity to diversity when reading and evaluating. And then the third part, I'm going to do something that we'll be reading between the lines of a review. So that will be from my perspective as a librarian who has used book reviews to do book selection. And now, you know, anytime I'm reading reviews, sometimes I think the reviews tell us something about the reviewer in addition to something about the book, sometimes even more about the reviewer, perhaps, than the book. So we're going to start off with the CCVC statistics. These, I think, are pretty well known, but for those of you who aren't familiar with them, I'll just say we started collecting statistics back in 1985. Initially, we collected the statistics just on books by Black authors and illustrators. And you can see that back in 1985, there were just 18 books that were by African-American authors and illustrators. And that was in a year when we received about 3,000 new books at the CCVC. So it was a very small percentage. And my colleague, Jenny Moore Cruz, was on the Coretta Scott King Award Committee in 1985. And that's how she knew exactly what number of books she had received for the committee. And of those 18, there were actually only 12 that had any kind of cultural content related to African-American experience, which is another thing the Coretta Scott King Award Committee looks at. They don't just look at books by Black authors and illustrators. They also look at books that depict African-American experience. So we were so shocked by that number that we decided to document it in our annual Best Books of the Year list, CCBC Choices. And then we did the same thing again the next year. The number continued to be 18 the next year. It was a magic number for a while. And then we started getting a lot of feedback about the statistics, and we continued to keep them each year until 1993, as you can see. And then after 1993, we began to get requests for books by other authors of color, Latinos, American Indians, and Asian Pacific Americans. And so in addition, we started keeping track of the books by those four groups, as well as the books about. And so this graph shows you from 1985 through...
Hey, Katie, sorry to interrupt. We're not seeing the graphs. We're just still seeing your entry slide. I think you might have to go out of presentation mode, and then we'll be able to see it. Sorry. Thank you.
I'll go back. Oops. All right. Let's see.
Now we can see it.
Okay. I'll stay in this mode then. Thanks for letting me know that.
Sure.
So this was the 85 to 93 slide. And then here's the more complex graph that shows the books by and about. And about are the dotted lines. So you see, for example, there are many more books about African Americans than by. It's the solid orange line underneath it that represent the books by. So then you also see the blue line are books by and about Asian Pacific Americans, the green Latinos, and the yellow line American Indians, which is right there at the bottom. Now, one of the things you'll notice when you look at the American Indian statistics is that the solid yellow line at the bottom, which are the books by Native authors and illustrators, is almost a flat line from 2002 to present. It's just, you know, really, really small number. But what you see when you look at the dotted line above it, and it gets kind of lost in the middle of all of the other ones initially, is that initially back in 1994 and right up through about 2003, there were many, many more books about Native Americans than by. But then we see that line drop significantly, and it's still higher than the books by Native American authors, but it is still just kind of running along almost in a plateau above it. And I haven't been able to prove this, but what I would hypothesize is that this may correlate to when Debbie Reese started her blogging and her reviewing, really taking a critical look at books about Native people that were being written by people who, well, really didn't have much of an idea what they were talking about. So it's an example of, the number of books about isn't necessarily a positive thing. Oftentimes the books about are stereotypical. If they're written by people from outside the culture that's being written about, they may not be accurate, they may not be authentic. And so I think that's actually a really interesting bit of information that the statistics, the graph here shows us. And then just to put it in another sort of graph for last year, in 2015, we also kept track on the graph of the books that were by, say, African Americans, but not about African Americans. So this would include, for example, Donald Cruz's books about vehicles. It wouldn't, Kwame Alexander has a book out this year with little animal characters. Those sorts of books that aren't about African American experience. So you see in 2015, that there were 104 books by African American authors and illustrators, and 14 of those were not about African American experience. But what you really see, which is a huge uptick from the previous year in 2015, is that there are 265 books about African Americans. compared to 104 buys. So many, many more people who are not African-Americans are writing about African-American characters or African-American subjects. Could be a biography of an African-American person, that sort of thing. American Indians, we move over to 2015. There were 18 books we documented by, 41 about, and then just one by an American Indian author that didn't have anything to do with American Indians. And the Asian Pacific Americans blocks are also, I think, very interesting because we see 174 about, by, and 112 about. And one of the things that's so fascinating in this is that when you look at the gray box there, 130 books by Asian American authors published in 2015 didn't have any Asian content. And I should say no observable Asian content to us. And so that means that of the books that are about Asians, Asian Americans, only about half of them are actually being written by Asians, but that Asian authors are writing many more books that don't have anything to do with Asian experience. This is something that Zeta Elliott blogged about last year. She interviewed a number of Asian American authors and Sarah Park Dahlen as well about why that might possibly be. And I really highly recommend that you go look up those two blog posts. I can send the link to Kira to send out to you because I think they're really fascinating. And then the Latino section that we see, the 58 books by, 82 about, and 18 by, but not about. I would say that for about the past 10 years, the books about and by Latinos have been, I think, fairly stagnant. We haven't seen a huge increase in the number of books by, and that's an area where, you know, like the last 10 years of books by and about American Indians, I think sort of the same thing. Whereas we see a lot more movement in the books about African Americans and the books by Asian Americans. And then one other graph, because what you might be thinking about is, well, how do these represent the whole? So we made a graph of the 2015, the blue, the big part of the blue pie chart are books on topics that are not by people of color, books on other topics. And you can read these things yourself, books on other topics by people of color. And the number of books about people of color is this, this pull out here. So you can see, for example, these are the number of books, this little circle are all the books about people of color. And of those, the yellow part of it are the ones that are actually written by people of color. So again, for all people, you see many more books about them being written by outsiders. Now this year at the CCBC, we're doing something a little different. We're still continuing to gather the statistics as we always are. Have done, but we are doing a pilot project just on our picture books, where we're drilling down a little bit with the statistics to get more than just, you know, the by and about numbers, but to look at a little bit more information about them. And this is a picture of our current picture book collections, one side of it. It's a two-sided shelving unit. So these are the new books we've received as review copies, and they're just shelved in order by their author. So we're collecting the in-depth diversity statistics on the picture books, just the ones published in the United States. We're not including the books we get from Canada or Australia, only the ones in US editions. So we're keeping track of, handling each book and analyzing it for its main character. So we're looking at species, human, animal, or other. This is has been inspired by a blog post a couple of years ago by Roger Sutton, where he felt that the multicultural statistics in general were skewed because so many children's books are about non-human characters. So we're taking a look at that and seeing what we find. So we're keeping track of species. We're keeping track of gender. We're keeping track of race, LGBTQ, disability, Muslims. And the reason we're keeping track of Muslim characters is that's something we're frequently asked about here at the CCBC. And then we're also looking at books that are the first books of their author or illustrator. So we're seeing, you know, who is getting published, who is being encouraged in these times. In terms of race, we break it down by white, African-American, American Indian, Asian Pacific American, Latinx, biracial, brown-skinned, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. And then general multicultural are those books that have a cast of characters where there isn't really a central character. It just shows a bunch of children, and they are all different races. Kind of a, it's a small world type of thing. And then we're looking also at secondary characters in two ways. We're looking for, there might be a white protagonist, but when it shows other people in the world, are they a diverse cast of characters, or are they all white? And we're looking at in secondary characters, like in a crowd scene, visible disabilities, gay and lesbian couples, women with Muslim head coverings, for example, biracial couples. And then we're also keeping track of genre, concept books, contemporary, historical, fantasy. So I wanted to give you our findings of as of July 1st. So it's our half year mark, and you're the first people to hear these statistics. So we've received and cataloged 472 total picture books so far this year. Of the 472, 233 had human characters, so just about half. 192 had animal characters, and 63 have other. That's 13%. So other equals, and these are just examples of 2016 picture books, about truck, robot, dragon, fairy, zucchini, a cupcake, main character who's a screw, Statue of Liberty, the numeral three, and a carton of milk. In terms of the gender of the main character, about just under 40% of them are female, and just under 62% are male. And then 37 are 8% are unknown. And those are mostly animal characters where you can't tell. They're written in first person and you can't tell the gender of the animal. In terms of race, of the 233 books about human characters, 63.5% of them have white characters. And then you can see the breakdown with the other groups, 7.72% African-American, 6.29% Asian Pacific American, 3% Latinx, and 8.85% Native American, 1.7 biracial. And then the multicultural cast, it's a small world type thing. And then the brown-skinned ethnicity unclear, 14.16%. This is a thing we've noticed as we've been logging the books. And I think this is a new thing, that there are more and more characters in children's picture books that just have brown skin and dark hair, and you can't tell. There's nothing else in the book about their ethnicity. These are mostly books that are illustrated by white illustrators. And it feels to me like they're just making a character who otherwise would have been white, a brown-skinned character. It's not a, I don't think it's a negative thing, but I think it's a very interesting kind of non-ethnic thing. But what is particularly fascinating is that when you add up all of the books about African-American, Asian, Latino, Native American characters, that adds up to about 18% total of all of the children that are clearly of a particular ethnic group. And so almost that same number of characters are brown-skinned, unspecified ethnicity. The characters with disabilities, I said, you know, as I pointed out there, we've seen four so far. And this is just an, actually, these are the four. So you can see what they look like. One book with a Muslim character, believe it or not, it's Ramadan, Curious George. This is a book that I still can't quite get over. But so far, that's the only picture book we've seen with a Muslim main character. And then LGBTQ+, the only book we've received so far, is a picture story about two worms that fall in love. And actually, I quite like this book. I think it's a really kind of funny, unconventional allegory about gay marriage. And then animal characters with ethnicities is another thing we've come up against. So you have Hansel and Gretel, ninja chicks who, appear to be Japanese chickens. They're dressed as ninjas, but they're also the background, the setting, they look like Japanese buildings. And then you have, this I think is one of the strangest books I've seen in a while. This is a book where the main character is a gnome. So he was categorized as other. But when you see the crowd scene or the classroom scene, in this case, it's a diverse cast of characters. You can see children of many ethnicities here. But what is up with these two rabbits in the class? They're never mentioned. They just are there in all the crowd scenes, and they appear to me, at least when you compare them to the white children in the picture, they appear to be rabbits of color, or at least bunnies of color. Here's another picture of them working in the garden. This is just a bizarre thing to me. And as a reviewer, you know, I don't even know what I would say about this or if I would say anything about this. It's a kind of conundrum for evaluation. And then in terms of first publications of the 472 picture books, 45 were debuts by author, and five of these were authors of color, and 33 were debuts by illustrator, and three of those were artists of color. So you can see those percentages of the books written or illustrated by authors and illustrators of color is about consistent with what we see in the overall totals of books. So we're not, in spite of the cry for we need more diverse books, we're not seeing a huge number of new authors and illustrators being ushered in yet. Maybe we will in a few years. The next part I'm gonna move on to is something about how you can sharpen your own critical skills when it comes to diversity. And you can't change who you are, but you can change your perceptions of the world. This is a photo of the Notable Children's Books Committee in, 1986. It was the first ALC committee I was on. And I'm the second from the right there in the black jacket. I look exactly the same today, I should add. This is I put this picture in because I think it's very typical of what award committees look like in ALSC. It's typical of pretty much every book evaluation committee I've been on. And I think it's typical of reviewers of professional journals in our country right now. There we are evaluating away. And the next year, after I finished Notables, I went through the 80s. I would say the 80s, I was kind of a book evaluation committee junkie. So the next year I was on the Newbery committee. And this is what my Newbery committee looked like, very much like my Notables children's book committee. We had one African-American member on that Newbery committee, and you can see her kind of in the middle of the picture in the gold jacket, not Lois Lowry, but the woman standing next to her right behind Caroline Ward and Kathleen O'Dean. And I point her out because that's Carla Hayden, who is our new Librarian of Congress. And Carla, you know, people are making a big deal about her being the first woman, the first African-American. I make a big deal about her being the first librarian of Congress, but she also started out as a children's librarian. And I was really, really grateful to serve on the Newberry Committee with her. She's a great book evaluator. The following year, I was on the Coretta Scott King Award Committee. I think I'm pretty easy to pick out in that picture. And I'm still wearing a black jacket. I kind of had the Johnny Cash look going on back then, I guess. And this, you know, these two committee experiences, I valued them both. I learned a lot from both of them. But I think I learned much, much, much more from the Coretta Scott King Award Committee. It was the first time I was on an award committee where I was in the minority. I was known as a non-Black member. It was the first time I was a non-something. Or called that I know of. And also just to hear the discussions, to participate in them, to listen to the evaluations of the books from an African-American perspective. And I won't say an African-American perspective, but African-American perspectives, because even two women on the committee who were both about the same age, who both grew up in Harlem, had very, very different views of the books we were discussing. So it was an incredibly valuable experience for me. And the Coretta Scott King Award Committee has always been an integrated committee. And it's a committee I highly recommend if you have an interest in diversity and particularly in African-American literature. And you're a member of IMRT, of ALA, I highly recommend you get involved with the Coretta Scott King Task Force, and maybe you'll be lucky enough to be appointed to the committee, because it is a great experience. So my first tip in term from just my own experience of starting out as a white woman, having lots of different experiences with book evaluation and discussion, my first tip is pretty simple, and that's learn to listen. I think those of us who are talking about books and evaluating books all the time are so used to wanting to talk and wanting to give our own opinions of things. So learning to listen is a critical thing, and learn to listen specifically to diverse voices. And there are some, you know, the internet actually makes this really easy, at least when it's working. And so there are blogs you can follow regularly. These are blogs that I highly recommend. And you see American Indians and Children's Literature, Debbie Reese's blog, for example, De Colores is a great blog. Zeta Elliott has a wonderful blog, Latinos in Children's Lit. You can read the list, Crazy Quilt Edie. Just a lot of opportunities to read and interact with diverse voices. But again, I think listening is really key. And then a number of people you can follow on Twitter. I just put some of the people that I follow and learn a lot from. These are just a few, but just as an example, I find all of these voices. Her last name has just gone right out of my head. She's a professor at Penn. Ebony Thomas. She is just an amazing thinker. And if you're on Twitter and you're not following Ebony, I really encourage you to follow her. And Pat Enciso, also a professor at Ohio State. She's just gotten onto Twitter, and she's also just an incredibly wise woman. And then there are a number of authors, and I put on particularly authors that often speak about diversity issues on their Twitter accounts, like Daniel Jose Older and Linda Sue Park, Melinda Lowe. So all of these are great people to follow. And then I put down below, you know, you don't have to just follow people in children's and YA lit or people in literature in general, but there are a number of good accounts you can follow. I find DeRay McKesson to be really valuable, and Roxane Gay and Native American Calling. These are just some examples of Twitter accounts that you can follow and listen in. And then also when you go to conferences, I really encourage people to take advantage of some of the great panels. And ALA makes it really easy now, because when you're looking at their events calendar, you can actually select diversity as your subject area, and it will show you all the programs across from children's and young adult and adult services that relate to diversity. So these are just examples of two programs from the last ALA. It's always hard when you're going to conferences. You oftentimes have to make choices like this. Let's see, do I go to hear Kevin Henkes speak, or do I go to this session on Native American or Wisconsin American Indian communities and how to teach about them? This is from a teachers conference. And these two were pitted against each other in a conference program. Number three, expand your personal and professional networks. If you're white and you have a lot of friends who all your friends look like you, it's time to expand your personal network. And I don't mean just going out looking for Asian friends, but there are ways you can do this. Now, professionally, it's a little more natural. For example, here at University of Wisconsin-Madison, I'm a member of the Equity and Diversity Committee for our School of Education, and that really allows me to interact with a lot of my colleagues who come from diverse backgrounds, and we all have this commitment to diversity. Within national organizations such as ALA, anybody can join Reforma or the Black Caucus or the Asian Pacific American Library Association, the American Indian Library Association, and IMRT. So once you start participating in these sorts of professional networks, you will find your personal network, expand your personal network naturally, because you'll find your kindred spirits, the people that you enjoy, you know, having a meal with, or someone you will always get together with at ALA after you meet them, and perhaps even expand your friendship beyond ALA. Four, don't assume stereotyping is a thing of the past. This is something I find seems to be true of a lot of people. You don't need to go dig up a copy of Little Black Sambo to give an example of a stereotype. And this is the thing I put up there on the screen as an example, is a question from a test that a middle school teacher in Alabama gave to her students just in May of 2016. And there was quite a uproar about it when one of the students cleverly took a picture of the test and with his phone and sent it to his mother, and she put it up on Facebook. So these are just sample questions. And this actually wasn't new. It's part of a test that's circulated for many years that some teachers have used. Some people have used it as kind of a joke, but there have been some teachers who've used it seriously with their students. And I would just say no students should be subjected to this kind of stereotype. We also find them in books. This is from last January. You probably heard about this book, Birthday Cake for George Washington. I scanned an interior spread from the book, which I actually don't see a lot online when people talk about it. This is the spread that I think is probably the most stereotypical, where you see up above all of the white people at George Washington's party dancing. You just see their legs, and down below in the kitchen, you see the slaves working on the meal they'll eat. And they all just look very happy. In fact, the little boy who's apparently gonna scrub a floor or something is about the happiest little floor scrubber I've ever seen. And so again, this sort of thing is still being published, and we're still having national conversation about this, about stereotyping in children's books. And then when you're working directly with kids, don't make assumptions about reading interests based on race or gender. Don't assume that every Black boy wants to read a book about basketball, or that boys won't read a book with a female main character. And don't assume that a white child won't read a book with a diverse character. And you really, you know, anyone knows who works with kids, you have to find out what their interests are and work accordingly. But I am really surprised at the number of times I hear librarians or teachers making assumptions about what kids want to read based on gender or race. Ebony Thomas, who I mentioned a little earlier, has actually done an extensive study on the reading interests of African-American middle schoolers. And what she's found is that they are, in general, their main interest is reading fantasy. These are a group of kids I worked with in Madison who, before I even met Ebony, proved this to be true because these are our kids who were really, really high on Akata Witch, which is a fantasy. And again, it's a fantasy with a female character. This boy was as into it as the girls were. And I also attended a conference on African-American children's literature at NYU a few years ago, where they had a panel of middle school students, all African-American boys, talking about their reading interests. And they all, to a kid, mentioned fantasy as their main reading interest. So, one of Ebony's students said he's tired of people giving him books about Black history or basketball. He said, that's all people think I want to read about, when all he wanted to read was the latest good fantasy book. And then the other thing, this is something I tell teachers and student teachers and education students and librarians all the time, the best way to increase your own knowledge is to read authentic literature. And it doesn't have to be even just children's and young adult literature. You can read adult literature. But if you're just starting out with children's literature, I think every librarian should read every book that wins Coretta Scott King, Pura Belpre, the Asian Pacific American Award, and the American Indian Library Award. Those are given out every other year. But every new winner and the honor books, if you feel so inclined, but if you would just read all of the CSK, all of the Belpre, all of the ILA, all of the APALA award winners, then you begin to build up your toolkit of what is authentic literature. And what that does is really help you when you're beginning to evaluate books in terms of authenticity. And that brings me to the last point, which is to learn to trust your gut instincts. When something doesn't quite seem right or quite feel right, sometimes that's because it's not, and or because something is stereotypical. This is an example of a book we had in a book discussion at the CCBC last year, which, you know, everyone thought was pretty funny. That's all a play on words with an illustrator who misunderstood the word fig and thought it was pig, P-I-G. So his illustrations throughout the book, this kind of dry nonfiction book about figs, he interpreted them as pigs. So you see pigs are found all over the globe. They're Mediterranean pigs, Turkish pigs, pigs in Australia, Chile, Bengal, Egypt, and Italy. And so on this particular page, you know, there's kind of like choose your own stereotype. But the one that really stood out to our group was the Egyptian pig, who is appears to be wearing a chador, and she's carrying an Egyptian flag. And then also, I mean, there's the edict against pigs in Muslim culture. So it struck some people as particularly offensive, this carrying the joke a little too far, perhaps. But this was also a picture that people interpreted different ways. One person thought it was Cleopatra. One person thought it was a nun. I mean, we all just weren't sure what it was, but in the end, you know, it's something that inspired a lot of conversation, whereas the first reading, you might just blip over it or not talk about it at all. And then lastly, I want to look at some reviews and what we see when we see them. And I've got just a couple of examples, and I'm going to actually use a book that's not even out yet, But it's been reviewed. It's gotten 3-starred reviews so far. And it actually has this great cover. I think the cover is amazing. And it sounds like a really great book. It got a starred review in Publishers Weekly. And it's, you can see from the plot summary, it says rival gangs, drugs, murder. These are what define the neighborhood of West Split, where T, Jimmy, Ketch, and Yo-Yo live. When T witnesses his older brother brutally murder a mentally impaired young man, he can't resist trying to help. Badly beaten up for his trouble, T is suddenly in the spotlight along with his friends. There's media and police attention, people mobilizing for change and gang intimidation. T's widowed mother wants to save him by sending him away, but at 15, he's determined to see things through no matter the cost, because this is his home. Minimalist verse, permeated with slang, fits of rough-edged characters and environment, Charlton Trujillo so eloquently depicts, then there's a quote from the book, the immediacy of the dialogue and T's fears heighten a volatile situation that is all too real and relevant. Charlton Trujillo gives voice to the unheard in this heartbreaking and powerful modern American story of friendship, family, and courage. So, you know, on the surface, it sounds like an interesting book. But when I was first reading the reviews of this book, I was really struck by the quoted material. In this particular one, it's Jive Brothers rolled in hard. They walked in tent. I didn't want nothing to do with their truth. Sometimes it don't matter what you want or intend, it's going to go how it go. So this seemed to be a passage that was partly in an approximation of Black English. The Jive Brothers part kind of threw me. It's something I haven't heard since the Jackson 5 in the 70s in Tiger Beat magazine. But then I learned in another review that Jive Brothers are the gang. But anyway, it just kind of, it sort of piqued my interest. And when I looked at the review more closely, to see, and again, this is for a starred review for the book. It starts out rival gangs, drugs, murder. This is what defined the neighborhood of West Split, where T, Jimmy, Ketch, and Yo-Yo live. This is what defined their neighborhood, rival gangs, drugs, and murder. And I thought, really? And then his older brother brutally murders a mentally impaired young man. Really? And then he gets beaten up for trying to help this boy. It's sort of, when I started to read it and I've kind of highlighted these things, I've got a couple more reviews where I've done the same thing for you. It's the kind of thing where I wish we were having more of a discussion, because I'd love to hear other impressions on this. But it's the sort of thing when I talk about trusting your gut reaction, this is my gut reaction to these reviews where, and I know this, the woman who wrote the book is not African American herself. The characters in the book are African American. So I just sort of began to wonder about the authenticity of the text. The book list review gives the same sort of plot summary. This is where I learned that the gang is named the Jives, and that it takes place in Cincinnati. And then when I started looking at this book, these boys are on their way to the basketball court to shoot hoops and holler at girls. And that struck me, well, possibly a little stereotypical. And then again, this boy is referred to as slow-witted. Beaten to death by a member of the Jives. It's still not clear to me why this this kid with cognitive disabilities is beaten to death. But anyway, again, there's info about the language, a unique, rich sound drawing on the rhythmic lyricism of slang rap and slam poetry, along with a sharp, evocative, semi-invented vernacular. And the semi-invented vernacular really struck me. Before I was a librarian, I was a linguist. And I know that you to invent a vernacular is just a little odd, especially when it's a semi-invented vernacular of a vernacular that exists, sometimes called Black English or African-American vernacular English, more commonly today. It has rules and a grammar. It's not just whatever a white person thinks Black English sounds like. And so it just really, really struck me. And it really stood out to me in the Kirkus Review, because it has more of this language. It has, for example, he want to have speak, and we all held our weight, which no Black English that I ever heard of. And it sound he want to have speak sound to me like Hollywood movies about American Indians, you know, the way they talk. He want to have speak. We all hold our weight. It's just very bizarre to me. So this review overall I find interesting because it's a starred review, but as I read the text in it, and I should probably give you a text to look at that I haven't all marked up, it doesn't read to me like a starred review, because it has things like only the free versus frequent apostrophes connoting a drop letter are stereotypical and distancing. A comment like that about a text being stereotypical and distancing, you know, the book might still be recommended, but I'd just be surprised it would be recommended with a star. But in any case, this Black girls and women are less well-rounded and seem in no danger of violence themselves, even in reference to real-world police murders. No Black women are named. So reading these reviews, which are, except for the Kirkus Review, they are very, very laudatory about this book. And as I said, this book isn't out yet. I just got an advanced copy and started reading it. And I'm about 150 words, pages into it. It's about halfway through. And I'm finding just a lot of kind of fake, really, really fake Black English, or this invented vernacular that is really hard going. Also, I find it very inconsistent in its language. And I find it just kind of rife with stereotypes that aren't really pointed out in the reviews. So I got very curious about how two other books that were written by African-American authors who know what they're talking about on a kind of a similar theme, how they were reviewed. So I went and looked up reviews for Tyrell by Coe Booth. And I went and looked up reviews by When I Was the Greatest by Jason Reynolds. Both of these books, like When We Was Fierce, deal with African-American teenage boys living in an urban area and kind of making their way through the world. And this is the review from Voya for Tyrell. And one of the things that the reviewer says is mastery of Tyrell's voice and dialect is the book's greatest accomplishment. In a lesser author's hands, Tyrell's speech patterns would be distracting, but with Booth, it is a natural fit. It's a glimpse at a place many readers will never visit and others will never leave. And I thought, boy, that's a kind of an interesting value judgment there. To show readers that life like Tyrell's actually happens. And let the record show that she provides the definitive tale of modern African-American urban youth. That just all sounded a little patronizing to me. Here is another review, this one from Kirkus for Tyrell. His DJ father is incarcerated for drug dealing. It uses the word slummy. Says it talks about his mom's ineffectual attempts. Inspired by his father, he decides to throw a secret dance party. And then it gives a little information about Coe Booth, and why she is able to tell this story. She clearly understands how teens living on the edge in shelters and projects and on the street live, talk, and survive. It's the slick street language of these tough but lovable characters with and her gritty landscape that will capture the interests of urban fiction fans. And then it talks about it being a convoluted plot, but that will undoubtedly illustrate the kinds of obstacles these teens must overcome. So it's really, you know, kind of a different, I think a completely different take on a similar book by a Black author. And this is moving to the Jason Reynolds one. This is from the Bulletin for the Center of Children's Books. And I don't know if you've all read Jason's first book, but it gives a little, when Alan Ellie Brooks is a good kid who manages to avoid street drama in his Brooklyn neighborhood, but the 15-year-old also doesn't have many friends other than his younger sister, Jazz. When Needles and Noodles, a pair of brother Ellie's age, move into a decrepit brownstone next door, Ali is willing to overlook their potentially troubling behavior to gain a couple of pals. Needles has Tourette syndrome, and his behavior is always a wild card in social situations. Noodles carries a load of resentment for how his brother's syndrome drove their father away and subsequently the family into poverty. And this, I thought this was a really interesting phrase. His anger manifests in a tendency toward thuggishness. But ultimately, this reviewer describes it as a neighborhood of flawed but kind grown-ups that can pull in harnesses to keep the kids on the right track. Moving to the next review of this book, it says that there's not a lot of action in it. It's more like a character study. Readers don't necessarily feel the danger due to the tender and deeply protective relationships of the characters. And what unfolds is a moving and thought-provoking study of the connectivity among family and friends that plays upon and defies readers' expectations. I thought that line was very interesting. Up until that point, I thought that this review reflected pretty much the book that I read. The Jason Reynolds book that I read, where I felt the strength was in the human connections among the people in the book, the main character, his friends, his community, the elders. It's a real sense of a place, and it gets beyond just sort of the flat stereotypical view of the inner city just being about guns and violence and drugs, but it really deals with the human element, the people that are struggling to live. And but then I get to that line where it plays upon and defies readers' expectations. That implies that we should come to these books with the expectation of there not being a whole lot of humanity in these situations. So I just, I was struck by that. And then the last review of the Jason Reynolds book starts out with a very odd line. I think a lesson in trusting your instincts. Never attend a party where you will be out of your league. Kind of an odd way to sum up a novel. He makes a surprisingly huge sacrifice to negotiate for his family's safety from revenge. This book's a review says the book is populated with stereotypes, but his loyalty to each one of them releases them from a box of totally annoying, predictable characters, which is quite a contrast to the review that talked about the flawed but likable adults. So, and then it also, again, mentions the language. Street talk abounds, but with a refreshing lack of foul language. So there's an expectation that street language will have foul language. Anyway, not to belabor the point too much, but and I'm still thinking about these reviews, but I just think it's a completely different feeling from what we got from the review written of the book written by the reviews of a book written by someone who has not actually lived the experience. And I don't know if it's because it reinforces the stereotypes white readers bring to the books to start with, or just that time has changed that much in the 2 years since these books were published, that there's just a greater appreciation for the books. But anyway, I'm going to stop here because it is almost 3:20 and can take questions. And I see there is one question that came in advance, which I will address. And if any of you else have questions, you can send those to me. But this question says, many librarians and children's literature scholars of color are motivated by social justice imperatives. They theorize on and critique children's literature as a way to normalize conversations about cultural diversity in children's literature, and by extension, kids' services, as a way to move diversity imperatives beyond the margins. Many want to change how public librarians and educators use and perceive diverse children's literature in their day-to-day practice, ideally in ways to support social justice. But this imperative is not felt by all. What type of strategies and resources can you recommend for those working toward normalizing conversations about equity in children's literature? Well, this is a great question. And it's, I think, kind of a little bit what I was trying to get at in the middle section. But I have this conversation or this frustration, I would say, a lot in diversity discussions where there are always people who are at square one in a diversity discussion. And then there are people who are at about square three, and then there are people at about square seven. And we always seem to end up focusing our discussions around the square one needs. And, you know, it's true with adult education, people bring different experiences and different knowledge to a table, a conversation. But, you know, it's after I've been doing this work now for over 30 years, and it gets really, really tiring to still be having conversations about whether you say Latino or Hispanic or American Indian, Native American, you know, and I was on a campus diversity committee a few years ago where every single meeting we tried to define diversity. And that just is, you know, like we never move forward in that way. So I think that one thing is to move. When you talk, I like the language in this question that talks about moving imperatives beyond the margins. And I think oftentimes diverse literature is marginalized. And we, you know, there's the old thing, we just bring it out for Black History Month or whatever. But I think one of the things that we can consciously do now is move it into the center in our libraries or our classrooms or lives, instead of just having it as something separate in a separate category. And one of the things I think that We Need Diverse Books has been doing that's really good is they do the, if you liked, try such and such, where they bring a diverse book in, but it's not, you know, like if you liked a book about a Black character, here's another book about a Black character. It's more, if you liked a book about a boat, here's another book about a boat where it would have some kind of diversity, diverse characters in it. So there's that. And then I found having the conversations with professionals, I'm kind of all over the map in this answer because a lot of things are sort of going off in my head at the same time. But I have found that the people in NCTE seem to be about 10 or 15 years ahead of the library profession. And I really, really like going to the NCTE conferences when I can, the literature part of them, because the discussions that relate to diversity there are so much deeper. And it's more interesting, and I'm not having to worry about any library related things like, you know, going to the exhibits to look for Xerox machines or something like that. So I can participate fully in the discussions at NCTE. And then the conference that follows, the Allen Conference, which is just related to YA literature, is also excellent. And they have so many diverse authors speaking at the conference. But the classroom teacher discussion at NCTE on diversity issues is just extremely rich. So I don't know if that even comes close to answering the question. And I'm going to switch back. I'm going to stop sharing screen so I can maybe see people. And if you have any other, here we go. My little reminder. Yeah, hi. Is there, I don't know if there's any way to interact beyond.
Hey, Katie, we did get, and thank you. That was an amazing presentation. Thank you for that. We did get a question or maybe a comment from one of our reviewers. I'm just pulling it up so I could read it. From one of our reviewers says, I really appreciate the special attention that you're paying. I think she's talking about the CCBC's statistical project on picture books. I appreciate the special attention to Muslim content right now, but I wish she broke it down by religion. As a synagogue librarian and past president of the Association of Jewish Libraries, I'd love to see stats on Jewish content in kids' books. So I guess might be wondering if that's in the...
So like looking at religion, in a broader thing. Yeah, we can, I can take that back to, you know, it's a work in progress, as I say. We've added a couple things, like we just added first books to it. And in picture books, I'm just trying to think, except, you know, we get some picture books that deal with Jewish holidays, for example. But there are, I think maybe I've seen a couple this year, but that's definitely something that we could also break down. And it's one of the questions we considered, because we also then went through like, well, is it Middle, should we be looking at Middle East or Muslim or what is it? But the question we get asked again and again is for picture books showing Muslim characters. And so, but as long as we're collecting the information from here on out, we can see if we can add that. And if there are other religious groups that, you know, religion is something that is pretty absent from picture books in general. We're just starting to see some children's and YA novels that are dealing a little more with religion. But in terms of trade books, unless you get books from specialized publishers, we just really don't see a lot. It might be different if we were doing the same kind of study in our nonfiction. And, you know, I'm thinking of some of the biographies, for example. And it would also be interesting to parse out, for example, if we were looking at books dealing with Jewish characters, how many of them would be historical, how many would be contemporary. Of the historical ones, would they be, you know, mostly during a particular time period? And that's one of the things we're just kind of working on as we go along and adding some categories. Or, you know, we came up with a whole issue with the brown-skinned characters when we were, you know, getting together as a group saying, how do we categorize this book? I can't tell. What ethnicity is this child? I can't tell. So thanks for that feedback.
Yeah, when you were presenting the new categories that you're collecting on, Shelley and I, you know, we're chatting about it. You know, we're sometimes confused too. You know, we get reviewers not sure how to describe within the context of the review the ethnicity or race of a character, because it's unclear. They have brown skin. Mm-hmm. And you know, on the editorial side, we've gone back and forth between, let's say that the character has brown skin, and sometimes we don't mention it. Mm-hmm. I think we're trying to err on the side of mentioning it because we've gotten feedback from librarians saying, even if the book is non-specific about race or ethnicity, if there's a brown skin character on the cover or that's a main protagonist in a picture book, I'm still mm-hmm. more likely to, I might be more likely, if it's a good book,
right,
to buy it because I would like that representation. So we've told reviewers to, you know, err on the side of mentioning it. You know, if there's not really cultural specificity and there's nothing in the text or illustrations to indicate anything beyond that skin color, you know, don't guess. You know, right. Be as just, you know, as clear as you can, and say the skin color is brown or however you want to describe it. We've had reviewers ask us that, and more information is better.
When I would find reviews, I would buy something that specified a brown skin character, because there was such demand, particularly when we were looking for picture books for Story Hour, and we have in Madison, Wisconsin, have a pretty diverse community that we serve, and so and those books are rare. That's the other thing. I mean, you know, it seems like a lot. What did I say? 33 books about brown skin characters, but that's out of 472. That's not very many. And I think that's one of the things that people don't realize is how many books there are about white characters. Picture books are about 25% of our total collection right now, and nonfiction, also about 25%. And then chapter books, which are mostly YA at this point, are about half of our collection. This would be a really difficult project with the young adult books because you can read into enough to get the main characters, but the secondary characters are harder to get without reading the entire book. And there are a lot of books we read, but we don't read every YA romance, for example. So, but now what do you all, you know, there now Kirkus is indicating if a character is white. Mm-hmm. And when I read those reviews, although I don't think in any of the Kirkus review and When We Was Fierce did they specifically mention an African American. I can't remember.
Yeah, I don't recall.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Anyway.
Well, we don't, as of yet, we don't have an official rule or guideline when it comes to race in our reviews. We feel that if it's important to mention, if it's integral to the plot, to the story, we definitely are going to mention it. And because we have received feedback from our readers that kind of information is important, they're making their decisions, we try our best to mention it, but at the same time, we would rather not guess and get it wrong.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it is difficult to discern, especially characters where like someone's skin is purple and the other character's skin is teal, and so what are you going to say, you know? And we feel like there's more room to make mistakes when we do it that way, instead of just trying your best to just state the facts and how it is.
Mm-hmm. What about those rabbits? What about those rabbits I showed?
Rabbits.
What is up with those rabbits? The bunnies of color. They're very cute. But yeah, I mean, we've had these conversations, especially when it comes to middle grade or YA, where there's no illustrations. Mm-hmm. And let's say it's a fantasy and it's, you know, set in some mystical, magical location, and, you know, and there's no indication of the ethnicity or the race of the main character. Mm-hmm. I think for us, where we're feeling this like tension is, do we say like the white 16-year-old, you know, fleet star captain or whatever, you know, goes throughout the universe? You know, unless there's evidence in the text or, you know, somewhere that this Starfleet captain is white, we've also, you know, we also don't want to be the ones to almost reinforce a white default by just assume, you know, so it's tough, you know, we don't want to perpetuate the idea that the white character is the default, is the norm.
Right.
And that we only mention a race or ethnicity when it's not white. We definitely don't want to be reinforcing that, but we also don't want to inadvertently make these decisions and just assume that the character is white when it's not stated. So that's why SLJ and, you know, on the editorial side and for our reviewers, we sort of don't have a, you know, one size fits all policy to always mention the race. And that's why we've given a lot of power to our reviewers and said, you know, if it makes sense to mention that they're white or black or Hispanic or Latino or whatever it is, mention it or describe it. And if it's problematic, definitely mention it, and describe as much as you can the stereotypical elements or the problematic elements. And you know, we're sort of in this weird period now where we're trying to figure out the best way to do that. And it's messy. So we don't have a great answer just yet, other than, you know, taking it one book at a time, one reviewer at a time. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if we have any other questions. I think we just we had some nice comments and some people. Oh, hold on. I got one thing from YouTube. One of our viewers says, maybe I'm expecting too much, but I was recently disappointed to review a book set in India where all the characters had uniformly tannish skin. There was no representation of the broader spectrum of India. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting, because we had a book recently too where we were discussing, it was beautiful, illustrated picture book, and we learned later from the author's note that it was set or is set in Burkina Faso, but the actual text itself doesn't mention it, and sort of had this like pan-African landscape. Mm-hmm. And editorially, we had a meeting, and our reviewer really likes the book, and we, I think, eventually gave it a really nice review, but we did have this conversation. This was looking at the galley before the author's note had come in. We didn't have any information about where this was set, and we said, you know, is this problematic that it just says Africa, and there's, you know, these huts in the background, and the character's going to get water, and there's certainly villages and places and countries in Africa where that's a reality, mm-hmm. of course, but it's not across the board that is, you know, a representation of all of Africa. Africa is a continent with many diverse countries and people and villages and situations. So, you know, we had that discussion, mm-hmm. and is that something we want to mention in the review? And then the author's note came in and we sort of decided there was enough information afterwards. But yeah, these things do crop up.
Mm-hmm. It's sort of similar to books about, what's her name? The little girl. My mind is not working today. The little girl who, Atunike is a Nigerian author who now lives in England, and she wrote the series of books about a little girl, and the text repeats, she lives in Africa, wonderful, amazing Africa. It keeps repeating that. And there was criticism from people that she said Africa instead of Nigeria. And some people felt she was perpetuating the stereotype that Africa is a country instead of a continent. But we asked the author about that, and she said, She wanted to counter the stereotype of Africans as all, you know, living in huts and that sort of thing. She wanted, the reason she chose Africa is, first of all, she said she loves saying amazing Africa. And second of all, she wanted children in England and Canada and the US to know that these sorts of cities, children living in these sorts of situations occur all across Africa, that it's not just specific to one nation, that you would find a child like this little girl living in all parts of Africa. So I thought that was an interesting response to that criticism. And the name of the book is going to drive me nuts. I can picture it, but I can't think of the name.
I did get, we can look that up though later. I did get just a follow-up comment from Heidi, who originally asked the question about religion. She says, would it be useful for the CCBC to see the list of Jewish content books developed each year by the Association of Jewish Libraries as they seek potential titles for their annual Jewish Kidlit Awards? We'd be happy to send you that info if it's helpful.
Oh, that would be helpful. For 2016, we've done that over the years, shared back and forth information with CSK and Belpre and Americus Award. There's a South Asian Book Award too that we share info back and forth. So, you know, sometimes we have books they haven't seen yet. Sometimes they have books we haven't seen yet.
Sarah Dalen, Dalen says, Anna Hibiscus, was that the book? Anna Hibiscus! Yes, of course.
I did not think of that name.
Thank you, Sarah. Excellent. We got a whole bunch of librarians watching.
Somebody's going to know.
Well, I don't see any other questions coming in. Some people did ask, is this video going to be saved with KT's information and slides? Yes, the entire video we will archive and put it on the course site. I wanted to also remind people that we're going to send out a survey probably tomorrow, if I can get it done tomorrow. Some other folks had asked within the course site, could we compile all of the links, all the different readings that were online, the videos, and everything into sort of like a syllabus with those hyperlinks? The answer is yes. Working on it now, and probably when I send along the survey, mm-hmm. we'll send along that as well. So you'll have all that information. And the course is going to stay up for a while. It may stay up indefinitely, but it'll definitely be up for at least 6 months or so, if not longer. We might eventually move platforms, but everyone can have access to it for quite a while. And one more comment from online from YouTube. Leticia, one of our reviewers, says the bunnies read like an exoticism of people of color. Mm-hmm. Oh. Interesting.
Yeah, really interesting. Yeah, they're just bizarre.
Why they're there, why they're bunny, I don't know. Yeah, it's odd. It's an interesting choice. Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to thank you again, KT, for taking the time
for all you're doing with this.
Yeah, and for bearing with our tech issues, and to all of you out there for bearing with the tech issues. This has been a really amazing capper, our final keynote to this course, but not the end of the work. You know, I feel like the work is just beginning. This was sort of our launching point for some deeper exploration and training. And I hope you've all enjoyed it and learned something.
And I think it's important to remember that this is something that we're going to continue to learn and possibly make mistakes and learn from those mistakes. And just remember what KT said at the beginning. Just listen to others, especially people's voices who are often marginalized.
Yeah, and if you're feeling a little nervous or, you know, concerned about doing a good job and doing this work as a reviewer, that's okay, because we're all feeling that. Mm-hmm. But that's a good feeling. We should all be a little concerned. We all should be slow and deliberate and thoughtful in this work, mm-hmm. Because it's important. And you know, the impact that our reviews have out in the marketplace and to librarians looking to build their collections and what books they're going to highlight or not. It's important work. It really is. But we're here to help. And, you know, if there's a question that comes up, like KT was saying, that gut feeling, if you're feeling weird and you're not quite sure how to articulate it in a review, just email us, you know. And chances are, even if we can't figure it out, we can reach out to some of our wider contacts in the kidlit world, mm-hmm. and ask for some advice and some guidance. So thank you all for taking the time. We love all our viewers. Yay. So much. And we love you, KT. Thank you so much. And we'll talk soon.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye. Bye, everyone.